Thank you. morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the inauguration of the Reverend Gregory F. Tusi of the Society of Jesus as the 37th president of Springfield College. This inauguration is a very special one, calling us together on the 150th anniversary of the presence of the Jesuits at Springfield College. And we are very pleased to have all of you here to witness this ceremony. We shall begin the proceedings with an invitation to Father Tusi's brother, the Reverend Roger Tusi of the Society of Jesus, pastor of Santa Maria Church in Olinda, California. Please stand with an invitation.
Let us call upon the God of history to be with us as we celebrate this 150th year in the inauguration of the 37th president of Springfield College. We call upon the God of Abraham and Sarah, the God of Isaac and Jacob. Throughout human history, you have called certain chosen ones to guide your people to new lands, to new visions, to greater service, and to deeper love. We call on the great tradition of Jesus himself and his mother Mary, of St. Ignatius Loyola, St. Edmund Campion, of Mother Teresa, and Gregory Tusi's parents, Gregory and Ella, whose lives reflect the sacred words of Micah the prophet, put to music. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to walk with each other, to walk humbly with God.
Thank you, Father Tusi. Please be seated. Any presidential inauguration is a celebration. For liberal arts educational institutions, it is a celebration of an ongoing process that is and has been for centuries at the heart of what it means to be most fully human. For a Catholic Jesuit liberal arts college, whose first Jesuit president was chosen 150 years ago, and which, like the rest of the world, stands on the brink of a new and exciting millennium. This particular inauguration is reason for both serious reflection and great celebration. We shall begin the ceremony with brief remarks from several of our distinguished guests, each of whom will issue a special charge to Father Tusi. The first is Mayor Michael Dow, Mayor of Mobile for the past 8 years, and recently re-elected for a third term. Mayor Dow.
Good morning. To Father Tusi, I honor you. To Father Rewan, Board of Trustees, and platform guests, all of our out-of-town visitors. very proud of our city, and I'm very proud of this magnificent university we have here at Springfield. Both Mobile and Springfield share a legacy of beauty, these beautiful oaks, the atmosphere, the culture we've created here in our community. We share a history of service and a history of progress, a commitment and dedication to those that we serve, pride in our institutions. We share a bright future if we continue in our focused effort to move our city and this university forward. And I promise you today, as a mayor of this city, a partnership with this university. And I can tell you that already Father Lucy has squeezed about $500,000 out of the drainage out here on this campus. We are very blessed to have a community with a lot of economic development and growth and downtown development, tourism, a lot of good things happening in our community. If we can get our public schools funded, I think that would help your institution and help the city as well. I have a straightforward charge this morning for Bob Lucy, and that is that he and his able staff work to strengthen this university more and to leave it a better place when they leave than they found when they came here. And I think that's the charge of political leaders and business leaders, educational leaders, to make your institution stronger when you leave. To take it into the next century with determination, to continue God's work, to continue the growth of your students and the progress of your students. And please work hard to give us a good mayor and city council people in the future, because we can't do it for about 20 years. Thank you much. Appreciate it.
Next, representing the First District of the State of Alabama and the United States House of Representatives is the Honorable Sonny Callahan, Congressman Callahan.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Governor Lucy, friends and Alabamians, it's a great opportunity for me to be here today to join you in this event. In my new capacity as Chairman of Foreign Operations in Washington, I have the opportunity to travel even to countries I had never heard of before becoming chairman. But regardless of where I go, inevitably, someone walks up to me. And when they're told that I'm from Mobile, Alabama, they always mention Springfield College. So what a great institution you are. And then when I travel in the country, in the United States, especially to academic areas, when you mention the name Ray Lucy, they are just as proud of him, and they're just as concerned about him as they are about Springfield College in America. So this is a great merger, a great educator, a great businessman, merging with a great educational institution in Springfield. And I'm happy to be able to join with all of you today and welcome you, Ray Lucy, here. I know you do a great job. God bless this institution.
Thank you, Congressman Callahan. Now, speaking on behalf of the student body at Springfield, is the President of the Student Government Association, Ms. Margarita Fernandez. Ms. Fernandez.
Thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, Board of Trustees, and members of the Society of Jesus. Good morning, Father Lucy. Without books, Springfield College will not cease to exist. Without teachers, Springfield College will not cease to exist. And as the fires of 1869 and 1909 have proven, without these beautiful buildings that surround us, Springfield College will not cease to exist. But without students, there would be no need or purpose for Springfield College. The students are the only reason for the existence of this great institution. On this day of great celebration, I, on behalf of the students, present and future, report to you, Father Lucy, a challenge. As the 37th president of Spring Hill, I challenge you to take this college into the next millennium, moving forward with technology and the advances of the human race, but not compromising the deeply rooted Jesuit traditions of the college. The students of Spring Hill have chosen to receive a Jesuit education. They value the Jesuit philosophy that tries to promote an integrated education, an education that guides us in developing as a whole person, morally, spiritually, intellectually, and socially. Father Lucy, it is up to you to preserve this community of learning. It is up to you to strengthen the college's mission that attempts to educate students to become responsible leaders in service to others. The students are yearning for leadership that is willing to become active within the college community. They want to see you eating the same food they eat daily in the cafeteria. They want to see you in the gym while they work off the extra bowl of ice cream they had for dinner. They want to see you supporting campus activities and supporting sporting events. But most important, they want to feel as if you understand. Understand their trials as young adults that are on their own for the first time. Understand their truth, the search for truth, and their development as individuals. Understand the obstacles that modern society has placed in front of them. They don't want a financial advisor for president, or a philosopher, or a preacher, or another parent. They want a compassionate human being, someone they can learn from through actions, a person they can admire and strive to imitate. Father Lucy, I have laid before you a challenging task. Yet I have no doubt in my mind that you can and will live up to this challenge. You are a wonderful human being, full of love, energy, and insight. On behalf of the entire student body, I would like to extend to you the sincerest of congratulations on such a grand occasion. It is a true honor to be able to call you President Lucy, the leader of Spring Hill College.
Father Lucy, my charge to you from a faculty perspective is from the point of view of a teacher of literature who is primarily an interpreter of the words of others. So it seems quite natural to set a context by giving three quotations from the writings and speeches of other people. The Spring Hill College Bulletin of Information states, quote, "The tradition and identity of Spring Hill have thus been formed from the strength of its Catholic heritage and its Jesuit spirituality and educational philosophy. Indeed, the college derived its academic character from its insistence on the primary importance of the liberal arts and sciences. It offers a multidimensional education, providing students the humanistic foundation for a life of continuous learning." Next, the philosopher George Santayana tells us in his Life and Reason that progress far from concerning change depends on retentiveness. And finally, a paraphrase of a statement by Father Gregory Lucy in his address to the college community, "My role as president is to help you become what you say you are." Father Lucy, I charge you first to fulfill your promise to help us become what we say we are, an institution that attempts to create a genuine community based on pursuits common to students and faculty of intellectual growth and personal development. An institution affirming in its philosophy of learning that ultimately faith and reason and justice are inextricably related to one another. An institution that advocates a call to Christian love. Help us mold ourselves into the college community that we say we are. Make us a cohesive aggregation of talented individuals with disparate roles, each recognizing the role and the value of each. help us find the strength to disagree with charity, to cooperate with love, and to fulfill our separate tasks with passion. I further charge you to help us understand that as we face the future of our college and our society under your leadership, we dare not dismiss the values of the past from which we have derived our institutional character. Help us avoid the pitfall which Santayana warns us, confusing change with progress. Help us not to dismiss our past as the repository of an outdated body of knowledge that no longer answers the problems of today. Give us the leadership that will help us educate our students to understand that in the context of the Catholic Jesuit tradition, humanism is not one of the problems confronting our society, but rather that cultivating a humanistic proclivity in the minds and hearts of our students is an essential step in a collective attempt to eradicate the isms of our world that are the problems, provincialism, sexism, racism, as well as the other non-physistic evils of poverty, inhumanity, intolerance, and injustice. Finally, I charge you to help us reaffirm that although an integral part of our mission is to prepare our students for productive and meaningful careers, that it is even more essential that we prepare them for life in its largest sense, to teach them the values and the truths and the precepts that will make them more than efficient accountants or good doctors or able lawyers or excellent teachers. In short, have us offer them the values that are so firmly embedded in our educational roots, values that deepen a sense of responsibility and the respect for the needs and rights of others, that promote the growth of social awareness and responsibility, especially through an appreciation of the fundamental solidarity of the human community and through the cultivation of a reflective sensitivity to human misery and exploitation. If you are successful in fulfilling these charges, I envision Springfield securing its essential niche in the educational structure of our country. I further envision another ceremony, perhaps the college's bicentennial celebration in the year 2031, when speakers reflecting on what will be their past and is to be our future, will find no need to utter a paraphrase of Melville's terrifying lament at the end of a story which articulates the failure of corporate society to deal with the problems of the individual, ah, Springfield, ah, humanity. Rather, let them see that we have lived up to yet another set of words from our history. He who was lifted up on the hill is the spring of wisdom.
Mr. Ed Overby, President of the Springfield College National Alumni Association, will now give his charge to Paul Lucy. Mr. Overby.
On behalf of the 8900 alumni of Springfield College, congratulations. As a member of the search committee, thank you for applying. For the purpose of these comments, the alumni will be divided into three groups. Current alumni, Spring Hill students who will be alumni, and those students not yet enrolled in Spring Hill College, but someday will be enrolled. For the current alumni, bring home those distant to the college by bringing the campus back to them, either through personal visits or frequent communication. As each year goes by, the memory blurs the experience of Spring Hill College, and your visits and communication can refocus these students and alumni to that experience. The second group is the current student body of Spring Hill College. Stay close to them. They're the future alumni of Spring Hill College. Your unexpected lunches and visits have had enormous impact on the campus already. But as an executive who moves forward and can stay deeply involved in the day-to-day management strategies of the organization, it takes a concerted effort and discipline to stay close to those in the field that are so important to the success of any organization. The third group is made up of those students who are children and grandchildren of alumni of Spring Hill College, those students in high school or grammar school or preschool. These young people already have a Springfield College experience through their parents and grandparents. They are our best candidates as students of Springfield College, and the college should make extra effort to enroll these students in the future years. One way this will be accomplished is through the Springfield College Family Endowment Fund, which is in its embryonic stage now, but in future years will be used exclusively for the benefit of children and grandchildren of Springfield College alumni. Springfield Alumni Association is currently raising funds for this effort. The following need your help to carry this message to all parties. These charges and expectations that come from the alumni to you, Bob, that we justly expect that you have expectations of the alumni, and we welcome them. When expectations of two parties are met and achieved, success and improvement follows, and ultimately that's what we all desire at Springfield College.
Mrs. Arlene Mitchell, a member of the Board of Trustees of the College, will now deliver the charge from the board. Mrs. Mitchell.
The Board of Trustees has chosen Father Greg Lucy as our 37th president. It was our deepest feeling that he is the person who can lead our distinguished strength to strength. Father Lucy, as we confer on you today the mantle of President of Springfield College, it is appropriate that the board publicly charge you with the commission to uphold the tradition of our college, to study well the history of Springfield as one of the premier liberal arts colleges in the South, and that you understand and foster the close relationship between Springfield and the greater Mobile community. We hope that you will invite the wisdom of the faculty and staff, friends and benefactors, to help you in a work of surpassing value for the future of our human community. The board also charges you to think creatively, judge with prudence and mercy, and to administer with a heartfelt love for the students, to keep alive the Jesuit vision of Ignatius Loyola, who wanted to serve the world in justice and faith. We ask, too, that you remind us daily of the words of St. Bernard. There are many who seek knowledge for the sake of knowledge. That is curiosity. There are others who desire to know in order that they themselves may be known. That is vanity. But there are some who seek knowledge in order to serve and edify others. And that is love. At this moment, Papa Lucy, we offer you our warmest welcome to Mobile and Springfield College. We do so in the certainty that time and again in the future, we will say to you, we're glad you're here.
As a matter of fact, Father Greg's existence was first brought upon my return home for Christmas vacation from Camden, a Jesuit prep school that I was then attending, I was informed by two of my sisters that our mother, who had just enjoyed her 43rd birthday, was pregnant. I was not shocked, but it must have been a bit of a surprise because almost two-thirds of a century have passed and I still remember the conversation.
Well, and
students of Springdale, both present and future, will benefit handsomely from the service of the community.
So that in the coming century, Springfield College can continue
conjunction with all our Catholic schools, shall continue to hold up the torch of higher education, enlightening and purifying by Christ's teachings all the arts and sciences. Father Lucy, as you began, you are not alone. Under your presidency, and what the Archbishop wrote by way of charge and prophecy for the end of the century, be even more true as the old century ends and the new millennium begins. God bless you all.
Rector of the Jesuit community and Director
Mr. Tim Clark, president of the Mobile Chapter of the Springfield College Alumni Association. And Mrs. Suzanne Jursa, senior class president. Archbishop Liston.
Gregory F. Lucy, by the power invested in me by the college charter of the Board of Trustees, I inaugurate you as the 37th president of Springfield College. I vest you with the symbols of your office, the charter of Springfield College, as a symbol of the responsibilities of your office, the college mace, carried at ceremonies as a symbol of your office. The college medallion, symbol of your presidency. To be worn at formal ceremonies. By vesting you with the symbol of office, the Board of Trustees delegates to you the appropriate power and authority to lead the college in fulfillment of its mission to educate students within the context of the Catholic, Jesuit, liberal arts tradition that has been the hallmark of Springfield College education since 1830. Do you willingly and wholeheartedly accept these duties and responsibilities? Ladies and gentlemen, I'm the 37th president of Springfield College, the Fairwell Convention.
Brother Pat's story reminds me of a conversation I had with my father. I can't remember what transition I was in, but I was leaving Campion and thinking about what I might do in the future. We were driving up to La Crosse along the river road, and I said, Dad, you know, you were a young man, relatively young, mid-40s. Single, had a good education, had a good work record, but you got another 20, 30 years ahead of you. What would you do? Well, he said, the first thing I'd do is get married. I said, Dan, I'm talking about myself. Oh, no, no, no. Archbishop Lipscomb, Father Bradley, Congressman Callahan, Mayor Dow, trustees of the college, delegates from our sister institutions, faculty, administrative and professional staff at the University College, parents and students, alumni and friends, my fellow Jesuits, and finally, my friends and family who have come so far for this occasion. I am truly blessed by your friendship and
Would the members of my family please stand? You just met my two brothers, my three sisters and their spouses, seven nieces and nephews, and the grandniece and grandnephew. Thank you for welcoming them. Family and friends are no small part of my life. With us in spirit today is our sister, Sister Eleanor, our father and our mother, who died 25 years ago. Throughout my life, I have been blessed by them. They are here in spirit because they formed us. From my father, we learned to take responsibility, to engage the reality of life. Without words, he assured us that we would make a difference. From our mother, we learned integrity. In response to her one line, be what you say you are. I am deeply grateful to all of you who are present here today. I am also deeply grateful to all of you who have worked so diligently for so many months to ensure that every detail of this event was covered, rain or shine. And a special thanks to the committee chair, Mr. Tom Lair.
Of the presence of Jesuits on this hill at the inauguration of Father Francis Beaufrelet. The Jesuits on this hill have been a valued presence to this region in war and in peace, in times of radical change and in times of stability. Father Cornette, a professor of mathematics and science, has left us an account of his ministry to the troops of the Confederacy throughout the war between the states. By contrast, Father Andrew Smith broke both the barriers of sex and race by opening the college to women and to people of color by the mid-1950s, a fact that Martin Luther King Jr. notes in his letter from the Birmingham jail. It was an alumnus of the college, Mr. Joe Langdon, who is here today, who had the vision and the courage to prepare the city to reshape the patterns of race relations in the 1960s, without the upheaval remembered in other parts of Alabama. The Spirit of God is in our midst. Today, this community is blessed with the progressive leadership, civic and religious, in the persons of Mr. Dow, Congressman Callahan, Judge Herman Thomas, Mrs. Mitchell, Dr. Watson, and Archbishop Lipscomb. I heard in their remarks an invitation, and I accept an invitation to be part of the team of persons committed to accompanying our people in different contexts as they and their culture make difficult transitions. I am blessed to be with you. As well, I am blessed to follow in the footsteps of those who have held this position before me. Father Billy Rhymes, who is unable to be with us today. Father Paul Tipton, a native son, who sailed this ship through heavy waters for 17 years. And Father Bill Rewan, who transformed this campus in 8 short years. And if it hadn't been for him, we would have been.
There are too many
to recount on this occasion. We must revitalize the core curriculum. We must increase our net revenue from students. We must build the endowment to ensure access to qualified students. But there is a greater and more radical challenge. It is to deepen our own spiritual and humanistic roots. It is to be what we say we are, that is, a Jesuit college in the 21st century. What does it mean to be this Jesuit college? Allow me to reflect with you on that question. Over the 450 years since Messina, and the 150 years since Rotelet, and the 30 and more years since the Second Vatican Council, we have had an opportunity to reflect on our experience and redirect our steps. What we learn now gives definition. What we learn now gives a definition to the Jesuit College, to Springfield College. In the 34th General Congregation of the Society of Jesus, we set forth what we have learned from our experience, especially in the last 30 years. Let me describe for you briefly five perspectives that must be characteristic of Springfield College if we are to continue to call ourselves Jesuit and be what we say we are. The first is a vision, a perspective on the integration of faith and justice. We have learned the radical integration of the first and the second commandment. Thou shalt love the Lord your God with your whole heart, with your whole mind, and all your strength. And the second, thou shalt love your neighbor as yourself. From its origin, the Society of Jesus has been dedicated to the service of faith. In the last 30 years, though, through the insights of the Second Vatican Council and the leadership of the Synod of Bishops in 1972, we have come to realize that we had lost our way. By allowing ourselves to tolerate radical injustices within the human family, we have allowed these injustices, this tolerance of these injustices, to permeate our society and become ingrained in the fabric of our culture, both civil and religious. No dimension of our lives is free of this insidious condition. We have been blessed with an insight, but have not been healed. We have been blessed in recent years with a vision of justice that is intimately linked with faith. It is deeply rooted in both the Hebrew and Christian scriptures, church tradition, and our Ignatian heritage. The vision of justice transcends the notions of justice derived from ideologies, philosophies, and particular political movements. It is the justice of the kingdom of God for which we are all called to struggle, whatever our religious tradition or lack thereof. I am speaking of an integration of faith and justice. Authentic spirituality demands both. We cannot have one without the other. If we are to call ourselves a Jesuit college, and if we are to be what we say we are, the awareness of the demands of justice joined to social responsibility to achieve it must characterize us as educators and people of faith. The second perspective is a deeper understanding and respect for culture. We must recognize that our world and that each cultural group is properly asserting the qualities of its heritage. We need to respect these diverse cultures in their self-affirmation and work along with them creatively. We must remember that we do not evangelize cultures, we evangelize people in their culture. Whether we are working in our own culture or in another, as servants of the gospel, we must not impose our cultural structures, but witness to the creativity of the Spirit, which is also at work in others. Ultimately, the people of a culture are the ones that move the church and the gospel in their lives. We have learned that God's action is antecedent to ours in whatever culture we are. We do not plant the seed of God's presence. God has already done that in every culture and in every person. Let me repeat. Ultimately, the people of a culture are the ones who move the church and the gospel in their lives. Therefore, if we are to be true to our Jesuit heritage, we must be involved in the transformation of the cultures of the region, as the men like Joe Langdon and Andrew Smith have done before us. First, we must come to appreciate the cultures of the Gulf Coast region with its distinctive history, recognizing the workings of God among us. The third perspective that I will share with you is that on the role of lay women and men in Jesuit higher education. Over the last 30 years, a growing cooperation with the laity has expanded the mission of Jesuit higher education and transformed its way, the way in which it carries out its partnership with others. We foresee the expansion of lay apostolic leadership in Jesuit higher education in the years to come, and we need to commit ourselves to assist that development. In the past, when Jesuits spoke of our school, they meant something very different than we mean today. Today, our signifies a genuine Ignatian partnership of laity and Jesuits, each acting according to our proper vocation. Laypersons are rightly taking on greater responsibility and leadership in Jesuit institutions, and I am delighted with the level of commitment, dedication, and readiness for leadership and responsibility that I find among the lay persons here at Springfield College. Please allow yourself to hear what I say. Next time you gather, hopefully beneath the oaks for an inauguration, you may be here to inaugurate the first lay woman or man. The fourth perspective regards ecumenism and interreligious dialogue. Ecumenism is not a technique for converting others to one's religious tradition. It is a new way of being Christian. We must do more than just be honest, truthful, and fair. We must attempt to work disinterestedly in the service of truth. We must seek to see things from the point of view of the other and take seriously the other's critique of one's own communion and its historic errors and failings. In short, we must seek what unites rather than what divides, seek understanding rather than confrontation, seek to know, understand, and love others as they wish to be known and understood, with full respect for all distinctiveness through the dialogue of truth, justice, and love. Finally, By making this statement, I wish to commit this college to do what we can to change this regrettable situation. I invite each one of you, especially those of you who play a role on this campus, to listen carefully and courageously to the experience of women, young and old. There is no substitute for listening. More than anything else, it will bring about change. With that said, and aware of the support that your presence affirms, I accept the presidency of Springfield College. To the best of my ability,
about that life of leadership and service to Springfield.
Hill College as its 37th president. It is therefore with great gratitude and with great promise that I, as your religious superior, provincial of the New Orleans province, mission you in this position as president of Spring Hill College. And as a sign of that mission, I present you with this crucifix as a sign of the cross that you will bear and the crown that you will wear in your service of the Church of Christ Jesus and of Spring Hill College.
Before we conclude, I should like to recognize two academic delegates who are not listed in the program, namely Father Maurice Shields, representing Loyola College in Maryland, and Ms. Julie Yard from Creighton University in Nebraska. Presidents of our sister institutions in Mobile, Dr. Frederick Witten, President of the University of South Alabama, and Mr. Walter Cabell, President of the University of Mobile. I now invite all present to join us for lunch in the Louise Moore Commons. Father Lucy, those on the platform, then the faculty and representatives from other learned institutions and societies will lead the reception, and you are invited to join in behind them. A chaplain and a college man will transport dignitaries and special guests to the Louise Moore Commons, and then it will be available to you if you wish to wait. We thank you all for coming and sharing in this occasion, and we especially thank Mr. Bretheim and the brass and choral ensemble. Please stand now for the benediction of Dr. Michael Lawson, pastor of Dalton Way of the United Methodist Church.
Let us pray. Almighty God, as we go from this impressive and meaningful service of inauguration, we pray that the grace and power of your Holy Spirit will go with us. Most especially, we pray that your servant, the Reverend Gregory Francis Lucy, will be directed by your divine guidance as he leads this great college into the future. We pray, merciful Lord, that adorned with wisdom and strength, kindness and love, he may faithfully perform all of the duties of his calling. Keep him humble and keep him from succumbing to difficulties and discouragements along the way. Help him to gladly seek instruction in your word and stir up the hearts of all who are connected to Spring Hill College so that we may cooperate with him and with your will for this institution. For the 167 years of Spring Hill College's unique and significant ministry of education, we praise your name, O Lord God. And now we go forth to be led into the coming years, praying that your mighty blessings will continue to fall upon the college under the presidency of Father Lucy. May the presence of God, the Creator, give us strength. May the presence of God, the Redeemer, give us peace. May the presence of God, the Sustainer, give us comfort. May the love of God, our Father, renew our hearts and minds. May the love of Jesus, the Son, call us afresh to humble service. And may the love of the Holy Spirit empower us to do the will of the Lord. and give you peace. In the sweet and strong and loving name of Jesus, our Lord.